In this video, we're going to talk about one particular way that you can get an entire class of students on devices individually using ChatGPT for a specific kind of learning. We're going to talk about how to use it for doing some Socratic method questioning, so that students can develop their understanding in that particular way. The prompt that I'm going to be using for this actually comes from a project called Caitlin's Cookbook, which comes out of Eton College from the Tony Little Research Centre they have there. I was introduced to this by an old colleague and friend of mine, Will Now. Thanks, Will. I'll put his link in the description. This is an amazing resource, actually, with loads of different kinds of prompts that you can use with ChatGPT, or that your students can use with ChatGPT. So in this session we're going to do now, we're going to lay down some ground rules, then we're going to talk about how you can set your students up with ChatGPT for Socratic learning, and we're going to do a lesson plan which can be applied to any subject you like. I'm just going to talk you through it, and I'm going to show you how it might work with a lesson plan that I might use it for, and then we'll think about what other kinds of lessons it could be used for as well. So the ground rules first. Well, ChatGPT can only be used by people over the age of 13, okay? It's in their terms and conditions. You've got to be over the age of 13. Schools are using it in the UK, but you've got to check with your school whether your school is happy for you to use it in the classroom. So go to whoever's in charge of that and find out. There's also a sort of legal requirement from OpenAI, the company behind ChatGPT. They want parental consent for anybody between the age of 13 and 18 to use ChatGPT. So you, again, have got to talk to your people at your school about whether your school is going to act in loco parentis to give parental consent for the students to use ChatGPT, or if you're going to have to get permission from parents. All of that stuff, don't neglect to do it. These are powerful tools, and there's a reason why parents have to give consent and why under 13s can't use it, because, you know, it doesn't always give the correct information, which we'll go on and talk about in a minute. And so it's very important that students are old enough to have the critical thinking skills to work out whether it's giving them the correct information or not. So go through those hoops. Hopefully your school has got an AI policy. Lots of schools are developing them now, so hopefully you've even had inset on this and you know whether you can use it or not and who you need to go to. Another thing you've got to do as part of the preparation is to check with your IT team that your students are in fact going to be able to access ChatGPT when they try to during the lesson, that it's not going to be blocked. So there has to be the permission there for them to be able to use it. Again, that's probably in your school's AI policy, if you've got an AI policy, and if it isn't, it should be. And all schools should have an AI policy. And so, you know, if you're starting to lead the way with your school going down that route, that's great. Get some other teachers together with you. See if you can convince your school to develop these ideas and to let the IT team give permission to ChatGPT in the classroom. As I was just saying then, these tools do not always get it correct. And the term for when they get it wrong is called hallucinating, which is a bit of a trippy term to use, I think. But hallucinating just means that it will sometimes give confident answers that are actually completely wrong. It doesn't actually happen very often, and with the new models, it's much better at getting things right. And depending on the kind of activity you're using it for, it doesn't matter so much whether its ideas are a bit wacky or not. So for example, in the last video I did where we were talking about brainstorming with it, who cares if it comes up with a few wacky ideas when you're a teacher? You know, you can sift those out very easily. But with younger children, if it gives them wacky ideas, then you've got to be a bit more careful. So definitely, before you get going, you need a session with the students where you explain that it can sometimes get things wrong. And you tell them that they've got to use it critically. They've always got to be asking, is this right or is it not right? And they should be checking with you, with a teacher, to find out if the teacher's view concurs with what the AI is saying. And in fact, the lesson plan I'm going to give you in a while does take account of this, because built into that lesson, there's going to be a whole aspect of students thinking about this tool critically. So we'll get onto that in a moment. Okay, so we're moving on to the lesson plan right now. And what you need is a device for every student. Maybe you go to your IT room, maybe you have Chromebooks in the classroom. Ideally, you have everything else shut down apart from ChatGPT, which is the only screen they're going to need open, the only tab they're going to need open during the whole lesson. If you have the ability to control that with Chromebooks, then fantastic. You don't want them browsing other stuff. Starter activity, something to do with the lesson that you are about to teach them. So I'm going to give an example from my subject, which is English. In the lesson I want to do, we're going to be looking at Macbeth and we're going to be exploring Act 1, Scene 5 of Macbeth. Okay, we're going to be using ChatGPT to help us with the Socratic method to explore it more deeply. Okay, so with Act 1, Scene 5 of Macbeth, a starter I might do is I might get students to write down four or five questions they've still got about that scene. We'd have read this scene in class previously, we'd have talked about it together. So the starter of this lesson, okay, write down four or five questions you've still got about this scene. We can return to those questions at the end in the plenary. We can see if ChatGPT has helped them to answer any of those questions. And in fact, at the end of the starter, you could say to them that when they get going with ChatGPT, if the opportunity arises, they can even ask that question to ChatGPT. Okay, so let's see what will happen when they log on to ChatGPT and what they're going to do. Okay, so here we are in Firefox, but you can go on any browser and you put in ChatGPT. And you're going to get up introducing ChatGPT and you click here, try ChatGPT. Your students can do this as well. And you don't need to sign in. You don't need an account. You don't need anything. You just need to click on that and you can get going. So you've got the free version here, which is currently ChatGPT 4.0 mini. So that's a simpler version of ChatGPT 4.0, but it's really powerful. It's stronger than 3.5, so it can do some really good stuff. They can make mistakes. It can make mistakes. It's important that you tell them that they shouldn't just carry on and try and start a new conversation in the same chat. If they make a mistake, they want to get rid of it, or they want to go back to this screen and click on try ChatGPT again and open up a different one and start a new conversation, okay? If they make some kind of mistake, or if they want to start again, or if it's kind of going off the rails, then that's what they should do. So I would set a time limit, say 20 minutes to play around with this. And I would probably, although you can decide for yourself, I would probably advise them to have a notebook next to them where they can make some notes about anything interesting that comes out of the conversation. And then what they're going to do is they're going to put in this prompt. Now, I'm going to put this prompt in the description below. As I say, it comes from Caitlin's cookbook. I'll put a link to that in the description below as well. So let's put in the prompt. Here it is. So I am now, here's where you put what subject you're studying and what level you're studying it at. So I'm just going to put I am a GCSE English literature student and I want to deepen my understanding of, okay, so I'm doing Macbeth, Act 1, Scene 5. That's it. That's a simple instruction. In fact, if you don't even want your students to fill in those gaps, you can just email them the entire prompt individually before the lesson begins and they can copy paste it in here. So let's just see how it goes. So we go, here we go. Great. Okay, so what's Lady Macbeth's initial reaction to the letter from Macbeth and what does this reveal about her character? Okay, so I will pretend that I'm foolish and I don't know the answer. So let's say she is very fearful. So that's not the case. She's actually quite excited to kill the king. There you go. Look, it knows I'm wrong. In the scene, Lady Macbeth does express concern. It's more focused on Macbeth's nature rather than fear. What's she worried about? Sorry. See what it comes up with. Wow, deep questions, hey? Why do you think Lady Macbeth believes Macbeth isn't capable of committing murder despite his ambition to be king? What does this tell us about her perception of power and the moral cost of obtaining it? Oof, she really wants... Okay, you can see I'm putting quite simple answers because I'm pretending I'm a 16-year-old. Let's dig a little deeper. How does her eagerness to get on with the murder reflect her attitude towards power and ambition? She doesn't. How would you compare her mindset to Macbeth's in this scene? She's more ruthless. Okay, now it goes on to a different bit of the scene. Unsex me here, films from the crown to the toe top full of direst cruelty. Okay, it prompts me to sign up or log in. I can just carry on. I don't need to do that. Okay, so it's pushing me to think more deeply, and it's just going to go on like that for as long as you want, because it's doing Socratic questioning. It's like Socrates in Plato's books. If you've read some of Plato's books, this is where the whole concept comes from, isn't it? Socrates is there, he's the philosopher, but he gets people to work things out for themselves by asking them questions constantly. And this is what ChatGPT will do with your students. Fascinating. It'll probably take them down routes you haven't discussed in class because it's just got so many different resources to draw on. It's got all the knowledge of the internet to draw on, so you can sort of go places with your students that you wouldn't otherwise have been. Fascinating stuff. This is why it's important to put a 20-minute time limit, right? Because it could just go on and on and on. It'll ask you questions, it'll ask you questions, it'll keep asking. So you put that time limit there. When it's done, you all come together. During that 20 minutes, you can be going around and monitoring. And so if you see this kind of conversation going on, you could say, you know, do you agree with that? Do you think ChatGPT is right there? Let's see what if I put this in. I'm going to put my English teacher hat on here rather than my 16-year-old hat on. Let's see what it thinks of that. There you go. Okay, so it agrees with me. Okay, now let's say I'm a 16-year-old student and I wanted to answer one of my questions from the beginning of the lesson in the starter. Okay. Okay, there we go. It's telling me about the context. It gives me a bit of an answer. And then at the end, it says, here's something to think about. Lady Macbeth's words reveal a lot about how society views power and gender. What do you think Shakespeare might be suggesting about how women's roles were viewed in relation to ambition and authority? Oh, that's brilliant. I mean, great. It tells me an answer and then it gives me a chance to respond to that. If I've read the answer carefully, I've kind of got the answer that I need to put in now in the response it's given. So I could just say, you know, I could copy paste it. Let's see what it does about that. Yeah, it doesn't remember that it just told me that a few minutes ago. There is always that possibility with ChatGPT that you can copy paste something that it has said and it will say, wow, amazing. But don't tell that to your students. Hopefully they'll just keep typing things in. And obviously, if you're monitoring, that's one of the kind of misbehaviors your students could be doing that you could shut down. Don't copy paste what it said before, come up with your own ideas. You know, okay, you can be talking to your students all the time about how important it is for them to write things down in their own words and to use this tool in a way that helps them to think in a more deep way cognitively rather than just a sort of copy paste tool. So you get this opportunity working with them in the classroom with ChatGPT to show them how to use it really well. Okay, and that's it. Fascinating, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, it's just amazing the way it can like keep going with a topic and can push students to think more deeply, and it really responds personally to where they're at. So it's just such an incredible tool, and I hope from that brief demonstration you can really start to get a feel for the potential of it in all kinds of different subjects. We'll come onto that in a moment, which other subjects you could use it for. But first, let's look at the plenary of the lesson. Okay, so what I would do is I would ask my students the following questions. Did you find out through that conversation with ChatGPT the answers to any of those questions from the starter? Do you remember I asked the students to write down 5 questions they still had? Did you find out the answer to any of those questions? That'd be the first thing for them to talk about. I think this plenary works well in groups, by the way, so they can be, you know, yeah, I found out the answer to this, I found out the answer to that. Then I would certainly be asking some questions that force your students to think critically about the power of ChatGPT and about whether it's right or whether it's wrong. So 2 questions I've got here are these. What do you think are the most reliable things you learned from ChatGPT here? Why do you think those things are reliable? What do you think are the least reliable things you were told by ChatGPT here? Why do you think those things are not so reliable? What could you do to check if those things are in fact correct? You know, and the answers you would hopefully get from your students there would be to ask their friends, to ask their teachers, to look in a textbook, to check with some reliable resources on the internet. All of that stuff is going to get them thinking really critically, isn't it, about ChatGPT and making sure that they don't just take everything it said for granted as the truth. Because it does have this tendency to talk very confidently and it leads you into feeling that it's always right. So it's so important to have those kinds of conversations with your students, and I hope you can see that from this particular lesson plan, you're actually getting this opportunity to put into the lesson a space for critical reflection. So I've used it here to do a lesson which would work in English. I mean, the potential is just amazing, but it could work with all kinds of subjects. If you go into Caitlin's cookbook, where I got this prompt from, the Socratic questioning prompt, you'll see that there are examples there that you can use, and I'm going to copy them into the description below here. I'm also going to copy the prompt into the description below here, of course. The other subjects that are given are A-level computer science student wanting to deepen your understanding of the paradigms of computer programming, an A-level politics student wanting to understand the structure, role and powers of the US Congress better, a GCSE math student wanting to get to grips with different number systems, integers, rational numbers, etc. But I'm sure with all your other subjects, you can think of tons of other applications for it as well, just with this Socratic questioning method. So go and have a go. Let me know how you get on. Let me know what you think of all this in the comments. I'm going to be doing more videos on these different specific prompts, so you can see different ways of using this free version of ChatGPT with your students. Give me a like, subscribe to the channel, and then you'll know when I'm going to post, or when I have posted, some more of these videos. Take care and enjoy working with ChatGPT.